Hello everyone, welcome to Avipedia. My name is Abhishek Sharma and today we'll be discussing contract farming in India. So contract farming as it is a big tool or instrumentality in the hands of the government, the private sector and the farming community today to help ensure the goal of doubling farmer income that the government has kept, which seems unfetchable, but this can be a way out for the government as well as for the farmers. Now, as far as contract farming is concerned, India has a long history with it. 1997 is the year when contract farming first started in India, and PepsiCo was the company which started it in Punjab when it started the tomato ketchup farming and food processing unit there. And since then, although PepsiCo has exited the ketchup business, but still around 12,000 farmers from Punjab are in contract farming with PepsiCo now for chips, potato chips. So all these possibilities are there. It is trying to align the strength of the corporate sector with the farming community, trying to ensure that there are better investment scenarios within the farming community and the agriculture as it is. So this can ensure the growth of the farmer, the growth of the rural India, and ultimately inclusive growth throughout India. So as it is, contract farming, if you look at it, we have to cover at least four basic things about it. What are the models of contract farming? What are its advantages? If it has any kind of limitations? And there is a recent Model Contract Farming Act, which has been given in 2018 by the Ministry of Farmers, Welfare and Agriculture. So this has to be taken into consideration for UPSC and all kinds of competitive exams, right? So as far as this topic is concerned, it remains in news with respect to the progressive adaptation of contract farming, which is happening in India, and the food processing industry, which the government is trying to push, especially if you see the Pradhan Mantri Kisan Sampada Yojana or the Matsya Sampada Yojana that were launched for this particular purpose. Now, the contract farming, if you think about it, is practiced under several models internationally. So some of these models, first off, we can take up is the centralized model. In this model, the contracting company provides all the necessary support to the farmer for production of any kinds of crops. Then it purchases the crops, processes it, packages it and sells it. Now, this kind of contract farming is under tight control of the private enterprise, whichever is working for this particular model. And it is generally practiced for high value crops like tobacco, sugar, cotton, paprika, cane, banana, these kind of coffee, tea, rubber plantations, even they are taken up under contract farming model, right? Then the second model for this particular act is the nuclear estate model. Under the nuclear estate model, what happens is now some direct quality regulations are required for certain crops, like for example, tea, rubber, or certain kind of palm oil kind of crops. So there, the company takes up and manages the estate and the plantation by its own and tries to provide a guaranteed required output and certain standardizations. So under that, it sort of manages it and tries to pay the farmers or whomsoever is working in the plantation on a monthly basis. So that is how it generally works. So tea plantations, for example, can be considered here. Then the third model is the multipartite model. Under this, the government, the state governments or the union government or the private sector and the farming community all can come together and decide what their role is going to be with respect to the whole value chain of the farming, whether it is the raw material, whether it is the production, whether it is the inputs, whether it is the forward value chain. So all these things are taken into consideration. And this multipartite model is practiced in various kinds of crops. For example, cocoa is created here. So Mexico, Kenya and West Africa, these are some of the countries where this model is under practice. Then there is another informal model. So here, for example, some seasonal fruits or vegetables, they are picked up under this informal model. So informal contracts are done by intermediaries with the farmers and they or the small entrepreneurs. They do informal contracts with the farmers and they are just limited to picking up that fruit or vegetable and then repackaging it and selling it to some outlets like Big Bazaar or Reliance Fresh or something like this. This kind of informal contracts are also into business and in India they are proliferating every day now. Okay. Then if you look at the next model, that is the intermediary model. So under this model, the companies make formal subcontracts with the intermediaries such as agents, aartiyas and so on, or NGOs or farmer producer organizations. And these intermediaries then essentially tie up through informal models with the farmers, and then they intend to create a whole contract farming environment, and under that they go on to work with it. And Southeast Asian region, this is the most practiced model, this is the intermediary model, because the companies don't like to deal directly with the farmer at the ground level, so that's how they are trying to work on it. Okay, then advantages. If you look at the advantages of the whole contract farming thing for the farmer, so first is in terms of credit. Because of the contract, the farmer is able to access easy credit. Then it helps in skilling of the farmers, helps them diversify their crops, and protects them in any kind of price risk situation. For example, if the supply sometimes outpaces the demand because of better productivity yield, then there is a crisis of surplus which the farming community at times faces, and the contracts can then help them in coming out of these kind of crisis. Then there is new markets which get open to the farmers through this contract farming, not just within the country as well as outside the country. So this happens. Then if you look at the limitations or the environmental impact, so there is a lot of negativity with respect to contract farming that has been studied internationally. So first off, this particular thing leads to sort of a monoculture. For example, if a farmer is having a contract with respect to potatoes or tomatoes or whatever, so he will continuously keep growing that particular crop, and that monoculture practice is erosional for the soil. And then if you look at it, the fertilizer response ratio, the pesticide response ratio, everything sort of goes down. Soil health deteriorates, productivity deteriorates over a period of time, and ultimately it again challenges the very theme with which we started contract farming, that is the farmer's income or the biodiversity impact. Both ways, it's negative in the long term, so it has to be managed and it has to keep on rotating accordingly. Then there is over-exploitation of groundwater. Then there are problems like environmental cost, to which the private firms, they are not bothered about because they are not directly even responsible for it. So this kind of negative practices, they create a lot of limitation on the possibility and acculturation with respect to the contract farming in many of the developing countries. Now, presently in India, what is the existing regulatory structure with respect to this contract farming? So, see, agriculture in India is a state subject, and as it is, the state governments have to make the laws to regulate the same. Now, under the Model APMC Act 2003, there were certain guidelines for contract farming which were given. So, around 20 states, although they amended their APMC acts according to these guidelines, but only 14 states up till 2018 have given their notification with respect to contract farming guidelines and rules, you know. So therefore, only in 14 states in India, this contract farming is as it is possible right now. Now, the change which has come in to set up new dynamics is the Model Contract Farming Act 2018, which was given by Ministry of Agriculture and Farmer Welfare. Now, this particular act tends to rejuvenate the contract farming environment in India. Especially, this has become important because of the marginal land size which the farmers have, and they are not able to put as much money into the farming as much is required right now, and it is not meeting their aspirational needs. So for that purpose, what is now being thought of by the government is that farmers should be brought in to a sort of a consortium, sort of farmer producer organizations or companies, and these can then get into contract with the private firms. They can pool their land, they can do contract farming accordingly. So this is now being talked about. In any case, India is into a sort of a not monoculture, then biculture in most of its agriculture states like Punjab, Haryana, Western UP. So they are into rice wheat kind of a farming. So this kind of farming is already there, so why not do it in a contract farming mode, which may help in diversification towards higher value crops as well. So this is what is being pushing the government for quite a long period of time, and this has led to culmination through the Model Contract Farming Act. Now, when we see the Model Contract Farming Act, this whole act has been made putting farmer as a centerpiece, because he is the weaker of the two parties concerned. So most of the areas within this Model Contract Farming Act are protecting the farmer, his land and his ownership of land. Right. So as it is, there are important aspects, such as there will be a registering and agreement recording committee or an officer who will help both the farmer and the private corporates to engage into contract farming. And this contract farming will be done now outside of the ambit of the APMC Act. So the state governments don't need to, as it is, amend their APMC Acts, and they can continue with the contract farming outside the Act. And whatever is contracted, it will not be just limited to crops. It can also be extended to livestock. It will be covered under the insurance. And moreover, not just the farm produce, but all the value chain which is happening post-production also and pre-production also have been included in the contract farming's ambit, so that the final value addition chain can at whole be captured under this Act. So it is creating a great leverage for contract farming in the coming future in India. And moreover, certain things have been integrated within the Act, such as no permanent structures can be developed on farmers' land, no right or title or interest of the land shall vest in the sponsor, then FPOs can become the contracting parties, or ensuring buying of the entire pre-agreed quantity for one or more agriculture produce, livestock or anything that has been given. Then accessible and simple dispute settlement mechanism has also been done. See, under the previous regime, APMCs were the dispute management authorities, and now they are trying to create dispute management authorities at the state level. So all these things are trying to create an enabling environment for the contract farming as it is in India. So if the farmers can utilize this, not 100%, then at least 20-30%, even if they utilize it, definitely the farming community's incomes are set to rise. Definitely the private investment in agriculture is set to rise. So this opens ground for most of the multinational companies which have already been doing this business, most of the Indian companies which are coming into food processing industries right now, and government stance with respect to protecting and promoting farmers' income. So all this is creating an enabling environment, and maybe we see the agriculture growth rates picking up, which have been stagnant at around 3.5-4% for the last 10 to 20 years in India. And that really needs to be rejigged for India to have an aspirational growth which it wants for its farmer as well as the whole economy. So thank you so much for watching. This is me, Abhishek Sharma, signing off. You should subscribe to the YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get all the latest updates on basic economic concepts which are being asked in UPSC and all the competitive examinations. So for any clarity with respect to this particular topic or any other topic with respect to economy or any other help you need in your prelims examination, you can write in to me at abhishek@abhipedia.com. Thank you so much. All the best for you.